हेलो फ्रेंड्स, आई होप यू आर डूइंग वेल। आज 6 फरवरी हो चुका है और 27 फरवरी को ज़्यादा दिन नहीं है, मात्र 21 दिन है, जबकि बीच में आपका फिजिकल एजुकेशन या फिर ड्राइंग का भी एग्ज़ाम होगा। तो भैया, आज से अभी से अगर आप नहीं लगते हो यार, तो बाद में परेशानी होने वाली है। तो मैं बार बार रिमाइंड करा रहा हूँ। चलो, 7th चैप्टर की बारी है, इवांस ट्राइज एंड ओ लेवल। कोलिन डेक्सटर, बिफोर यू रीड, शुड क्रिमिनल्स इन अ प्रिजन बी गिवन द अपॉर्चुनिटी ऑफ लर्निंग एंड एजुकेशन? क्या सोचते हो भैया? मेरे को तो लगता है एक बार में ख्याल आता है हाँ, लेकिन बहुत सतर्कता से, क्योंकि उन्होंने एक अपराध किया हुआ है, तो नाटक भी कर सकते हैं चालाक लोग। ठीक है, तो ऐसा नहीं है। रीड एंड फाइंड आउट वॉट काइंड ऑफ द पर्सन वॉज इवांस, वॉट वर द प्रिकॉशंस टेकन फॉर द स्मूथ कंडक्शन ऑफ द एग्जामिनेशन। ड्रामेटिस पर्सोने, द सेक्रेटरी ऑफ द एग्जामिनेशन बोर्ड, द गवर्नर ऑफ द एच एम प्रिंसटन ऑक्सफोर्ड, जेम्स इवांस अ प्रिजनर, मिस्टर जैक्सन अ प्रिजनर ऑफिसर, मिस्टर स्टीफेंस अ प्रिजनर ऑफिसर, अ रेवरेंड एस एम मैकलीरी इन्विजिलेटर, मिस्टर कार्टर कॉमा डिटेक्टिव सुपरिटेंडेंट, मिस्टर बेल डिटेक्टिव चीफ इंस्पेक्टर। ऑल प्रिकॉशन हैव बीन टेकन टू सी इट दैट ओ लेवल जर्मन एग्जामिनेशन अरेंज इन द प्रिजन फॉर इवेंट्स डज नॉट प्रोवाइड हिम विथ एनी मीन्स ऑफ एस्केप। इट वॉज इन अर्ली मार्च वेन द सेक्रेटरी ऑफ द एग्जामिनेशन बोर्ड रिसीव्ड द कॉल फ्रॉम द ऑक्सफोर्ड प्रिजन। इट इज स्लाइटली अनयूजल रिक्वेस्ट गवर्नर, बट आई डोंट सी वाई वी शुड नॉट ट्राई टू हेल्प जस्ट द वन फेलो यू से दैट्स द चीप दैट्स इट चैप कॉल्स इवेंट्स स्टार्टेड नाइट क्लासेस इन ओ लेवल जर्मन लास्ट सेप्टेम्बर, सेज ही इज डेड कीन टू गेट सम शॉर्ट ऑफ एकेडमिक क्वालिफिकेशन। इज ही एनी गुड? ही वॉज द ओनली वन इन द क्लास, सो यू कैन से दैट ही इज हैड इंडिविजुअल ट्यूशन ऑल एट द टाइम। रियली वुड हैव कॉस्ट हिम अ पैकेट इफ ही हैड बीन आउटसाइड। वेल, लेट्स गिव हिम अ चांस, शैल वी? दैट्स जॉली काइंड ऑफ यू। वॉट एग्जैक्टली द प्रोसीजर नाउ? ओह, डोंट वरी अबाउट इट, आई विल बी सेंडिंग ऑल यू द फॉर्म्स एंड द स्टफ। वॉट्स हिज नेम? यू से इवांस, जेम्स रॉडरिक इवांस। इट साउंडेड रैदर ग्रैंड। जस्ट वन थिंग गवर्नर, ही इज नॉट अ वायलेंट शॉर्ट ऑफ फेलो, इज ही? आई डोंट वॉन्ट टू नो हिज क्रिमिनल रिकॉर्ड और एनीथिंग लाइक दैट, बट नो, देयर्स नो रिकॉर्ड ऑफ वायलेंस। क्वाइट अ प्लीजेंट शॉर्ट ऑफ चैप, दे टेल मी, बिट ऑफ कार्ड रियली, वन ऑफ द स्टार्स ऑफ द क्रिसमस कॉन्सर्ट, इमिटेशंस, यू नो द सॉर्ट ऑफ थिंग, माइक यार्डवुफ स्टफ। नो, ही इज जस्ट अ कंजेंटिनल क्लेप्टोमैनियक। दैट्स ऑल द गवर्नर वॉज टेम्प्टेड टू एड समथिंग एल्स, बट ही थॉट बेटर ऑफ इट, ही वुड लुक आफ्टर दैट पर्टिकुलर साइड ऑफ द थिंग्स हिमसेल्फ। प्रिज्यूमेबली, सेट द सेक्रेटरी, यू कैन अरेंज अ रूम वेयर, नो प्रॉब्लम, ही इज इन द सेल ऑफ हिज होन। इफ यू हैव नो ऑब्जेक्शंस, यू कैन सिट द एग्जामिनेशन इन देयर, दैट्स फाइन। एंड वी कुड इजिली गेट वन ऑफ द पर्सन्स फ्रॉम सेंट मेरी, वन ऑफ द पर्सन्स फ्रॉम द सेंट मेरी मैक्स टू इनविजिलेट, इफ दैट्स फाइन। येस, दैट सीम टू अ लॉट ऑफ पर्सन्स देयर, डोंट दे? द टू मेन चकल्ड गुड नेचुरली, एंड सेक्रेटरी हैड अ फाइनल थॉट। एट लीस्ट देयर्स वन थिंग, यू शुड नॉट हैव मच ट्रबल कीपिंग हिम इनकम्युनिकेडो, शुड यू? द गवर्नर चकल्ड पोलाइटली वंस मोर, रीइटरेटेड हिज थैंक्स, एंड स्लोली क्रैडल्ड द फोन। इवांस इवन द ब्रेक एज द प्रिजन When prison officers called him, thrice he had escaped from the prison, and but for the recent wave of unrest in the maximum security establishment up north, he won't now be gracing the governor's premises in Oxford. And governor was going to make absolutely certain that he won't be disgracing them. Not that Evans had a big burden, just a persistent nagging presence. He would be all right in Oxford, though the governor would see to that, would see to it personally. And besides, there was just a possibility that Evans was genuinely interested in O level German, just a slightly possibility, possibly possibility, just a very slight possibility. At 8:30 p.m. on Monday 7 June, Evans' German teacher shook him by hand the heavily guarded recreational block just across D wing. Guten Glück, Herr Evans. Pardon, I said good luck. Good luck for tomorrow. Oh, thanks, ER. I mean ER, danke. डेंक शकोन यू हैवंट अ कैट इन हेल्स चांस ऑफ गेटिंग थ्रू ऑफ कोर्स बट आई मे सरप्राइज एवरीबडी सेड इवांस एट 8:30 द फॉलोइंग मॉर्निंग इवांस हैड अ विजिटर टू विजिटर्स इन फैक्ट ही टक्ड हिज ग्रबी स्ट्रिंग वेस्ट इनटू हिज इक्वली ग्रबी ट्राउजर्स एंड स्टूड अप फ्रॉम हिज बंक स्माइलिंग चीयरफुली मॉर्निंग मिस्टर जैक्सन दिस इज इंडीड एन ऑनर जैक्सन वॉज द सीनियर प्रिजनर प्रिजन ऑफिसर ऑन डी विंग एंड ही वांस ऑलरेडी बिकम वार एनिमीज एट जैक्सन साइड स्टोर ऑफिसर स्टीफन्स अ बर्ली श्योरली लुकिंग मैन ओनली रिसेंटली रिक्रूटेड टू द प्रोफेशन जैक Jackson nodded curtly. And how's our little Einsteining this morning? Then wasn't a mathematician, Mr. Jackson. I think he was a Jew, Mr. Jackson. Ivan's face was unshaven, and he wore a filthy-looking red and white hobble hat upon his head. Give me a chance, Mr. Jackson. I was just going to shave when you burst in, which reminds me. Jackson turned his eyes on Stephens. Make sure you take his razor out of the shell. When he is finished scraping the ugly mug of his clear, one of those he will do us all the favor and cut his bloody throat. For a few seconds, Evans looked thoughtfully at the man standing ramrod straight in front of him. A string of Second World War medals proudly paddled over the paraded over his left breast pocket. Mr. Jackson, was it you to take my nail scissor away? Evans had always worried about his hands and your nail file too. Look, for a moment Evans' eyes smoldered dangerously, but Jackson was ready for him. Orders of the governor, Evans, he leaned forward and leered, his voice dropping to a harsh, contemptuous whisper. You want to complain? Evans shrugged his shoulders slightly. The crisis was over. You have got half an hour to smarten yourself, Evans, and take that bloody hat off me at her. Evans put his right hand lovingly on the top of 50 woolen and smiled sadly. Did you know, Mr. Jackson, it's the only thing that's ever bought me any sort of lucky warm, if you know what I mean. And today I thought, well, with me exam and all that, buried somewhere in the Jackson was a tiny core of compassion, and Evans knew it. Just this once, Thane Shirdi Temple, if there was one thing that Jackson genuinely loathed about Evans, it was his long wavy hair and get shaving. At 8:45 the same morning, the Reverend Stuart M.C. Leary left his bachelor flat in the Board Street and stepped out of Brisky towards Carfax. The weatherman reported temperatures considerably below the normal for early June, and a long back overcoat and a shallow crowned clerical hat provided welcome protection from the steady drizzle which had set in the half an hour earlier and which now spattered the thick lenses of his spectacles. Is his right hand, he was carrying a small brown suitcase which contained all he would need for his morning duties, including a sealed question paper envelope, a yellow investigation form, a special authentication card from the examination board, a paper knife, a Bible. He was to speak to the women's bill that afternoon on the Book of Ruth and current copy of the Church Times. The two-hour examination was scheduled to start at 9:15 a.m. Evans was lathering his face vigorously when Stephens brought in two small square tables and set them opposite each other in the narrow space between the bunk on the each side and on the other distempered stone wall. Next, Stephens brought in two hard chairs, the slightly less battered of which he placed in front of the table which stood nearer the cell door. Jackson put in a brief final appearance. Behave yourself, laddie. Evans turned and nodded, and these, Jackson pointed at the pin-ups off. Evans turned and nodded again. I was आई वॉज गोइंग टू टेक एम डाउन एनी वे मिनिस्टर इजंट इट द चैप कमिंग टू सिट इन आई मीन एंड हाउ डिड यू नो दैट आस्क्ड जैक्सन क्वाइटली वेल आई वुड टू साइन आई हैड टू साइन सम फॉर्म्स आई डिडंट आई एंड आई कुड नॉट हेल्प Evans drew the razor carefully down his left cheek and left a meat and left me at sweat in the white leather. Can I ask you something, Mr. Jackson? Why did they have to bug me in this shell? He nodded his head vaguely to a point above the door. Not a very neat job, considered Jackson. They are taking no chances. Evans, nobody in his senses would take any chance with you. Who is going to listen in? I will tell you who is going to listen in, lady, is the governor himself. See, he don't trust you bloody inch, and nor do I. I will be watching you like a hawk, Evans, so keep your nose clean, clear. He walked towards the door. Evans nodded. He had already thought of that, and the number 2 handkerchief was lying ready on the bunk, a neatly folded square of white. Einstein. Just one more thing, Einstein. Yeah, what's that? Good luck, old son. In the little lodge just inside the prison's main gates, the Reverend S.M.C. Leary signed his name neatly in the visitor's book and then walked side by side with a silent prison officer across the exercise yard to D Wing, where he was greeted by Jackson. The wing's heavy out door was unlocked, and the lock behind them, the heavy inner door the same, and M.C. Leary was handed into Stephen's keeping. Get the razor, murmured Jackson. Stephen's nodded. Well, keep your eyes skinned clear. Stephens nodded again, and M.C. Leary, his feet changing up the iron stairs, followed him new guide and finally stood before a cell door where Stephens opened the peep hole and looked through. That's him, sir. Evans, facing the door, sat quietly at the farther of the two tables, his whole attention riveted to a textbook of elementary German grammar. Stephens took the key from its ring, and the cell lock sprang back with a thud metallic twang. It was 9:10 a.m. when the governor switched on the receiver. He had instructed Jackson to tell Evans of the temporary little precaution. That was only fair, as if Evans would not spot it. But wasn't it all a bit theatrical, schoolboyish almost? How on earth was Evans going to try anything else on today if he was so anxious to make another break? Why in heaven's name hadn't he tried from the recreational block? Much easier, but he hadn't. And there he was now, sitting in a locked cell, all the prison officers on the alert, two more locked doors between his cells and yard with a wall as high as a haystack. Yes, Evans was so safe as houses. Anyway, it would not be any trouble at all, and to have the receiver turned on for the next couple of hours or so, it wasn't as if there was going to be anything to listen it, was it? Amongst other things, an invigilator's duty was to ensure that the strictest silence was observed, but still, that little nagging doubt, might Evans try to take advantage of M.C. Leary, get him to smuggle in a chisel or two or rope ladder? Or the governor sat up sharply. It was very well getting rid of any potential weapon that Evans could have used, but what about M.C. Leary? What if, quite unwittingly, the innocent M.C. Leary had brought in something himself, a jackknife perhaps? And what if Evans held him hostage with such a weapon? The governor reached for the phone. It was 9:12 a.m. The examinee and the invigilator had already been introduced by the Stephens and Stephens when Jackson came back and shouted to MC Leary through the cell door, "Can you come outside a minute, sir? You too, Stephens." Jackson quickly explained the governor's worry, and MC Leary's patiently held out his arms at shoulder level, whilst Jackson lightly frisked his clothes. "Something hard here, sir." "My reading glasses," replied MC Leary, looking down at the spectacle case. Jackson quickly reassured him, and behind, down on the landing, thumb flickered the catches on the suitcase. He picked up each envelope in turn, carefully passed his palms along their surfaces, and seemed satisfied. He ruffled curiously, though, a few pages of Holy Rite, and vaguely shook the Church Times. "All right, so far." But one of the objects in MC Leary's suitcase was puzzling him sorely. "Do you mind telling me why you have bought this, sir?" He held up a smallish, semi-inflated rubber ring, such as a young child with a waist of about 12 inches might have smuggled into. You thinking of going for a swim, sir?" MC Leary, hitherto amiable demeanor, was slightly ruffled by this tasteless little pleasantry, and he answered Jackson somewhat sorely, "If we must know, I suffer from the hemorrhoids, and when I am sitting down for any length of time, very sorry, sir, I don't mean to, the embarrassment was still reddening Jackson's cheeks when he found the paper knife at the bottom of the case. "I think I would better keep this though, if you don't mind, sir." "That's it, sir." It was 9:18 a.m. before the governor heard their voices again, and it was clear the examination was going to be more than a little late in getting underway. MC Leary, "Yes, have got a watch. Evans, yes, sir." MC Leary, "I will be telling ye when to start, and I will be telling you when to start, and again when you have 5 minutes left." "All right." Silence. Evans, "There's plenty more of this writing paper should you need it." Silence. MC Leary, "Now write the name of the paper 021-01 in the top of the left hand corner." MC Leary, "In the top right hand corner, write your index number 313, and in the box just below that, write your center number 271. "All right." Silence. 9:20 a.m. MC Leary, I'm now going to Evans. He is going to stay here, is he?" MC Leary, "I don't know about that. Stephens, Mr. Jackson given me strict instructions to Evans. Hope am I supposed to concentrate on my exam with somebody breathing down my neck? Christ, sorry, sir, I didn't mean." The governor reached for the phone. "Jackson? Ah, good. Get Stephens out of that cell, will you? I think we are perhaps overdoing thing." "As you wish, sir." The governor heard the exchanges in the cell, heard the door clang once more, and heard MC Leary announce that the examination had begun at last. It was 9:25 a.m. and there was a great claim. At 9:40 a.m. the examinations board rang through, and the assistant secretary with special responsibility for modern languages asked to speak to the governor. "The examination has already started, no doubt. A quarter ऑफ एन आवर अगो येस वेल देर वॉज अ करेक्शन करेक्शन स्लिप विच सम फूल हैड फॉरगॉटन टू द प्लेस इन द एग्जामिनेशन पैकेज वेरी ब्रीफ कुड द गवर्नर प्लीज येस ऑफ कोर्स आई विल पुट योर स्ट्रेट थ्रो टू मिस्टर जैक्सन इन डी विंग होल्ड द लाइन अ मिनट वॉज दिस शॉर्ट ऑफ टाइम द गवर्नर हैज फियर्ड वॉज द फोन कॉल अ फेक सम सिग्नल सम सीक्रेट मैसेज बट ही कुड चेक ऑन द इमीडिएटली ही डायल द नंबर ऑफ द एग्जामिनेशन बोर्ड बट ही हर्ड ओनली द स्टैकैटो ब्लीप्स ऑफ अ लाइन इंगेज्ड बट देन द लाइन वॉज इंगेज्ड वॉजंट इट येस रियली वेरी इंटेलिजेंट दैट टू मिनट्स लेटर ही हर्ड सम विस्पर्ड कम्युनिकेशन इन द सेल एंड देन एम्सिलियरीज ब्रोड स्कॉट्स वॉइस will you please stop writing a while Mr. Evans and listen carefully candidates offering German 021-1 should note the following correction on the page 3 line 15 the fourth word should read goldenen not golden should read golden not golden and the whole phrase will therefore read zum goldenen loven not zum goldeni loven I will repeat that the governor listened and smiled he had taken German in the sixth form himself and he remembered all about the agreements of adjectives and so did ancillary by the sound of the things for the minister's pronunciation was more impressive but what about Evans he probably didn't know what an adjective was the phone rang again the magistrate's court they needed a prison van and couple of prison officers remand case and within 2 minutes the governor was wondering whether that could be a hoax he told himself not to be so silly his imagination was brinking to run riot Evans For the first quarter of an hour, Stephens had dutifully peered through the peephole at the intervals of 1 minute or so. So after that, every 2 minutes at 10:45 a.m., everything was still all right. As he looked through the peephole once more, it took 4 or 5 seconds, no more. What was the point? It was always more or less the same. Evans, his pen between his lips, sat staring straight in front of him towards the door seeking it seemed some sorely needed inspiration from somewhere and opposite him ancillary seated slightly askew from the table now his face in some profile his chair at Stephen's had noticed earlier amateurishly clipped pretty closely to the scalp his eyes behind the pebble lenses peering short-sightedly at the church times the right index finger hooked beneath the narrow clerical collar and the fingers of the left hand and the nail meticulously manicured slowly stroking the short black beard at 10:50 a.m. the receiver crackled to life and governor realized that he would almost forgotten Evans for a minute Evans please sir a whisper Evans please sir louder Evans would you mind if I put blanket round me shoulder sir it's a bit parky in here isn't it silence Evans there's one on me bunk here sir Ancillary, be quick about it. Silence. At 10:51 a.m., Stephens was more than a little surprised to see a grey regulation blanket wrapped round Evans' shoulders, and he frowned slightly and looked at the examinee more closely. But Evans, the pen still between his teeth, was staring just as vacantly as before, blankly beneath a blanket. Should Stephens resort the slight irregularity? Anything all... At all fishy, hadn't Jackson said. He looked through the peephole once again, and even as he did so, Evans pulled the dirty blanket more closely to himself. Was he planning a sudden Batman leap to suffocate ancillary in the blanket? Don't be daft. There was never any sun in the side of the prison, no heating either during the summer months, and it could get quite chilly in some of the cells. स्टीफन डिसाइडेड टू रिवर्ट टू हिज अर्लियर एवरी माइन्यूट ऑब्जर्वेशन एट 11:20 AM द रिसीवर वंस मोर क्रैकल्ड अक्रॉस द साइलेंस ऑफ द गवर्नर्स ऑफिस एंड एंसिलरी इन्फॉर्म्ड ईवांस दैट ओनली 5 मिनट्स रिमेन्ड द एग्जामिनेशन वॉज ऑलमोस्ट ओवर नाउ बट द समथिंग स्टिल जी नॉड गनॉड गनॉड स्टिल जी नॉड नॉड जी यहाँ पे साइलेंट होगा ना स्टिल नॉड अवे क्वाइटली इन द गवर्नर्स माइंड ही रीच्ड फॉर द फोन वंस मोर एट 11:22 AM जैक्सन शाउटेड अलॉन्ग विद द कॉरिडोर टू स्टीफन्स द गवर्नर वॉन्टेड टू स्पीक हिम हरी मैन स्टीफन्स पिक्ड अप द फोन एप्रीहेंसिवली एंड लिसन टू द रैपिडली स्पोकन ऑर्डर्स स्टीफन्स हिमसेल्फ वॉज टू कंपनी एंसिलियरी टू द मेन प्रिजन गेट्स अंडरस्टूड स्टीफन्स personally was to make absolutely sure the door was locked on events after ancillary has left the door understood at 11:25 AM the governor here heard the final exchanges ancillary stop writing please silence ancillary put your sheets in order and see they are correctly numbered silence scrapping of chairs and tables events thank you very much sir ancillary all right was it even not bad sir Ancillary goods, Mr. Stephens, very loud. The governor heard the door clang for the last time. The examination was over. How did he get on? Do you think? Asked Stephens as he walked beside ancillary to main gates. Oh, I can't think. He's distinguished himself. I'm afraid his Scots accent seemed broader than ever and his long black overcoat reaching almost off his to his knees fostered the illusion that he had suddenly grown slimmer Stephens felt pleased that the governor had asked him and not Jackson to see ancillary off the premises and all in all the morning had gone pretty well but something stopped him framing his way directly to the canteen for a belated cup of tea he wanted to just take one last look at Evans it was like a program he would have seen on TV about he had seen on TV about a woman one could never really convince herself she had gone to bed often she would got up 12 15 sometimes 20 times to check the bolts he re-entered D-wing made his way along the Evans cell and opened the peephole once more oh no Christ no there sprawled back in Evans chair was a man for a semi second Stephens thought it must be Evans a gray regulation blanket slipping from his shoulders in the front of his closing cropping irregularly tufted hair awash with fierce red blood which had dripped along already through the small black beard and was even now spreading horribly over the white clerical collar and down into the black clerical front Stephens shouted wildly for Jackson and the words appeared to penetrate the curtain of the blood and the wheeled ancillary's ears for the minister's hand felt feebly for a handkerchief from his pocket and left it to his bleeding head the blood seeping slowly through the white linen he gave a long low moan and tried to speak but his voice trailed away and by the time Jackson had arrived and dispatched Stephens to ring the police and ambulance the handkerchief was a sticky squelchy wedge of cloth ancillary slowly raised himself his face twisted tightly with pain Dina worry about the ambulance man don't worry about the ambulance man I'm all right get the police I know where he is he closed his eyes and another drip of blood splashed like a huge red raindrop on the wooden floor his hand felt along the table found the German question paper and grasped it tightly in his blood-stained hand get the governor I know where Evans almost immediately Sirens were sounding, prison officers barked orders, puzzled prisoners pushed their way along the corridors, doors were banged and bolted, and phones were ringing everywhere, and within a minute, MC Leary, with Jackson and Stephen supporting him on either side, his face now streaked and caked with drying blood, was greeted in the prison yard by the governor, perplexed and grim. We must get you to hospital immediately. You have called the police? Yes, yes, they are just on the way, but I'm all right. Look here. Awkwardly, he opened the German question paper and thrust it before the governor's face. Is there? Did you see what I mean? The governor looked down and realized that MC Leary was trying to tell him a photocopied sheet and had been carefully and cleverly superimposed over the last originally blank page of the question paper. Yes, see what they have done, governor. You see, his voice trailed off again, and the governor, dredging the layers of long neglected learning, willed himself to translate the German text before him. See solen dem schon very Bredeton plan genio folgen der which tig zit put pukt ist drei minute war indies examines. You must means matlab in bracket matlab in quote, you must follow the plan already something. The vital point in time is 3 minutes before the end of the examination, but something don't hit him too hard. Remember, he is minister, and don't overdo the Scots ancient when. अच्छा ये मतलब था उसका. A fast approaching siren wailed to its crescendo. The great doors of the prison yard were pushed back, and a white police car squealed to a jerky halt beside them. Detective Superintendent Carter swung himself out of the passenger seat and saluted the governor. What's the hell happening, sir? And turning to MC Leary, Christ, who's hit him? Who has hit him? But MC Leary cut across wherever explanation the governor might have given. Ellsfield Way officer, I know where's Ivan. He was breathing heavily and leaned for support against the side of the car, where the imprint of his hand was left in tarnished crimson. In the bewilderment, Carter looked to the governor for guidance. What? Take him with you if you think he will be all right. He is the only one who seems to know what's happening. Carter opened the back door and helped MC Leary inside, and within a few seconds, the car leaped away in the spurt of gravel. Ellsfield Way, MC Leary had said that there it was, staring up at the governor from the last few lines. His German text from Ellsfield Way drive to the Headington roundabout, where, yes, of course, the examinations board was in Ellsfield Way, and someone from the board must have been involved in the escape plan from the very beginning. The question paper itself, the correction slip. The governor turned to Jackson and Stephens. I don't need to tell you what's happened, do I? His voice sounded almost clam to its scathing contempt. Read and find out. Will the injured MC Leary be able to help the prison officers track Evans? So almost clam in its scathing contempt. And which one of the two morons was it who took Evans for nice? Little walked to the main gates and waved him bye-bye. It was me, sir, stammered Stephens. Just like I told you, you say. What the hell? When you rang, sir, and told me to. When was that? Governor's voice was a whiplash now. यू नो सर अबाउट 20 past 11 जस्ट बिफोर यू ब्लिटरिंग इडियट मैन इट वॉजंट मी हु रैंग यू डोंट यू रियलाइज बट वॉट वॉज द यूज ही हैड यूज द टेलीफोन एट दैट टाइम बट ओनली टू ट्राई अनसक्सेसफुली वंस मोर टू गेट थ्रू टू द एग्जामिनेशन बोर्ड ही शुक हिज हेड इन ग्रोइंग डिस्पेयर एंड टर्न्ड ऑन द सीनियर प्रिजन ऑफिसर एज फॉर यू जैक्सन हाउ लॉन्ग हैव बीन गिवन प्रिटेंडिंग यू हैव गॉट अ ब्रेन ए वेल आई विल टेल यू समथिंग जैक्सन योर स्कल्स एम्प्टी योर स्कल इज एम्प्टी एब्सोल्यूटली एम्प्टी आई इट वॉज जैक्सन हु हैड स्पेंड 2 hours इन द इवान्स सेल द प्रीवियस इवनिंग एंड इट वॉज जैक्सन हु हैड कॉन्फिडेंटली रिपोर्टेड दैट देर वॉज नथिंग हिडन एनी वेयर नथिंग एट ऑल एंड येट इवेंट्स हैड समहाउ मैनेज टू कंसील नॉट ओनली अ फॉल्स बियर्ड अ पेयर ऑफ स्पेक्टेकल्स अ डॉग कॉलर एंड ऑल द रेस्ट ऑफ द क्लेरिकल पैराफर्नेलिया बट ऑल्सो सम सॉर्ट ऑफ वेपन विथ हीम ही हैड गिवन एंसिलियरी सच अ टेरिबल ब्लो अक्रॉस द हेड और प्रिजन वैन बैक्ड अलॉन्ग साइड बट द गवर्नर मेड नो इमीडिएट मूव ही लुक डाउन अगेन इन द लास्ट लाइन ऑफ द जर्मन टू द हेडिंगटन राउंड अबाउट वेयर यू स्ट्रेट ओवर मेक यू गो टू न्यू ग्रेबन वेयर ऑन द अर्थ न्यू समथिंग न्यू ग्रेव नेवर हर्ड ऑफ इट न्यू देयर वॉज वेव वॉर ग्रेव समवेयर नियर रीडिंग बट नो इट वॉज प्रोबेबली अ कोड वर्ड और देन इट हिट हिम न्यूबरी गॉड येस न्यूबरी वॉज अ प्रिटी बिग शॉर्ट ऑफ प्लेस बट ही रैप्ड आउट हिज ऑर्डर्स टू द ड्राइवर स्टैक डेट्स पुलिस स्टेशन एंड स्टेप ऑन इट टेक जैक्सन एंड स्टीफन्स हियर एंड वेन यू गेट देयर आस्क फॉर बेल चीफ इंस्पेक्टर बेल गॉट दैट ही लिफ्ट द स्टेयर्स ऑन हिज ऑफिस थ्री एट टाइम बट बेल ऑन दैट फोन इमीडिएटली एंड पुट द फैक्ट्स बिफोर हिम विल गेट हिम सर्स सेड बेल वी विल गेट हिम विथ अ बिट ऑफ लक द गवर्नर सैट बैक एंड लिट अ सिगरेट येस गॉड्स वॉट अ ब्यूटिफुली लेड प्लान इट हैड बीन वॉट अ क्लेवर फेलो इवान्स वॉज केयरलेस लिविंग दैट क्वेश्चन पेपर बिहाइंड बट देन they all made their mistakes somewhere along the line well almost all of them and that's why very very shortly mr clever evans would be back inside doing his once more the phone on his desk erupted in a student burst and superintendent carter informed that ancillary had spotted evans driving off along Aylesfield way they had got the number of the car all right and had given chase immediately but had lost him at the Headington roundabout he must have doubled back into the city no said the governor quietly no he's on the way to Newbury he explains his reasons for believing so and left it at that iske baad mita hua hai kuch acha left that dash a police job now not his he was just another good for a giggle gullible governor that was all but the way Carter I hope you managed to get ancillary to the hospital all right yes he is at the Redcliffe now really groggy he was when we got to the examination offices and they rang for the ambulance from there the governor rang the Redcliffe a few minutes later and asked for the accident department ancillary you say yes he is a parson read and find out will the clues left behind on the question paper put Evans back in the prison again ancillary you say yes he is a Parson, I don't think There's anyone? Yes, there is. You will find one of the ambulances picked up him from elsewhere, Elsfield way about. Oh, that. Yes, he sent. Oh, that he sent an ambulance, all right. But when we got there, the fellow had gone. No one seemed to know where he was. Just vanished, not a sign. But the governor was no longer listening, and the truth seemed to him with an almost physical impact somewhere in the back of his neck. A quarter of an hour later, they found the Reverend S.M.C. Leary securely bound and gagged in his study of Broad Street. He had been there, he said, since 8:15 a.m., but two men had called, and inquiries in Newbury throughout the afternoon produced nothing at all, and by the tea time, everyone in the prison knew what had happened. It had been Evans impersonating M.C. Leary who had walked out. It had been Evans impersonating M.C. Leary who had stayed in. The fish and chips were delicious, and after the gentle stroll round the center of Chipping Norton, Evans decided to return to the hotel and have an early night. A smart new that concealed the wreckage of his closely wrapped hair, and he kept it on as he walked to the reception desk of a Golden Lion. It would take a long while for this hair to regain its former glories, but what the hell did that matter? He was out again, wasn't he? A bit of bad luck that Jackson had pinched his seizures, for it had made a long, tricky operation with his only razor blade that previous night. But he would have his good luck too. Just think, if Jackson had made him his bobble hat too, phew, that really had been a close call. Still, old Jackson wasn't such a bad fellow. One of the worst thing funny really had been the beard. He had always been allergic to sticking plaster, and even now his chin was irritating, sore and red. The receptionist wasn't the same girl who had booked him in, but this change was indefinitely for the better. As he collected his key, he gave her his best smile, told her he would not be bothering with him breakfast, ordered the Daily Express, and asked for an early morning call at 6:45 a.m. Tomorrow was going to be another busy day, he whistled softly to himself as he walked up the broad stairs he would sort of liked the idea of being dressed up as a minister, dog collar and everything. Yes, it had been a jolly good idea for M.C. Leary to wear two black fronts, two collars, but the top collar, phew, it had kept on slipping off the back stud, and there's been that one panicky moment when M.C. Leary had only just got his hand up to his neck in the time to stop the collars springing apart from Stephen's. They had got that little problem worked out all right. Throw a pin stuck in the mouth whenever the evil eye had appeared at the peephole is easy, but all that feeding about under the blanket was the black front and stud at the back of the collar. That had been far more difficult than they would have ever bargained for. Everything else had gone beautifully smoothly, though in the car he had found everything they had promised him. The soap and water, cloths and maps, yes, the maps, of course, the ordnance survey map of the Oxfordshire. He would ही हैड गॉट सम गुड फ्रेंड्स सम वेरी क्लेवर फ्रेंड्स क्राइस्ट आ ही अनलॉक हिज बेडरूम डोर एंड क्लोज इट क्वाइटली बिहाइंड हिम एंड देन स्टूड फ्रोजन टू द स्पॉट लाइक अ मैन हु हैड जस्ट कॉट अ ग्लिम्स ऑफ द गॉर्गोन सिटिंग ऑन अ नैरो बेड वॉज द वेरी लास्ट मैन इन द वर्ल्ड दैट इवांस हैड एक्सपेक्टेड और वॉन्टेड टू सी इट्स नॉट वर्थ ट्राइंग एनीथिंग सेड द गवर्नर क्वाइटली एज इवांस आईज डार्टेड डेस्परेटली अराउंड द रूम आई हैव गॉट मैन ऑल राउंड द प्लेस वेल देर वॉज ओनली टू रियली बट इवांस नीड नॉट नो दैट ही लेट द वर्ड सिंक इन वुमेन टू डिडंट यू थिंक द ब्लोंड गर्ल इन रिसेप्शन वॉज Rather sweet. Evans was visibly shaken. He sat down slowly in the chair. In only chair the small room could offer, and his head between his hands for several minutes. There was utter silence. Finally, he spoke. I was that bloody correction slip. I was posed. Well, the governor failed to mask the deep satisfaction in his voice. There are a few people who know a little German. Slowly, very slowly, Evans relaxed. He was beaten and he knew it. He sat up at last, managed a smile ruefully. You know it. It wasn't really a mistake. You see, we had not been able to fix any hotel, but we could have worked that some other way. No, the really important thing was for the phone to ring just before the exam finished to get everyone out of the way for a couple minutes. So we had to know exactly when the exam started, didn't we? And like a fool, I presented you with that little piece of information on a plate. Well, somebody did. So you see, sir, that correction slip killed two little birds with a single stone, didn't it? The name of the hotel for me and the exact name the exam started for. The governor nodded. It's a pretty common word. Good job. It's a pretty common, sir. I would never have known where to come to, would I? Nice name, though. Zum goldenen Löwen. How did you know which goldenen lion it was? There's hundreds of them. Same as you, Evans. In index number 313, center number 271. Remember, six figures, and you take an ordnance survey map of the Oxfordshire. You find that six figure reference. 313/271 lands you bang in the middle of the chirping notion. Yeah, you are right, huh? We had opted. You had run off to Newbury. We did. Well, that's something. That the question paper, Evans, could you really understand that German? I could hardly. Nah, course I couldn't. I knew roughly what it was all about, but we just opted. It had throw a few spanners in the works, you know, sort of muddle everybody a bit. The governor stood up. Tell me one thing before we go. How on earth did you get all that blood to pour over your head? Evans suddenly looked a little happier. Clever, sir, very clever. That was how to get a couple of pins of blood into a cell. When the invigilator, shall we say, get search before he comes in? Yes, sir, you can well ask about, and I don't know if I ought to tell you. After all, I might want to use that particular anything to do with a little rubber ring for piles. Perhaps Ivan grind feebly, clever though wasn't it? Must have been a tricky job sticking a couple of pins. Nah, you have got it wrong, sir. No problem about that. No, it's the clotting, you see, that's a big trouble. We got the bloody blood easy enough. Pig's blood, it was from the slaughter's house in Kingleton, in Kidlington. But to stop it clotting, you have got to mix your actual blood. Evans took a breath. With 1/10 of our own volume of 3.8% trisodium citrate, didn't you know that? Did you, sir? The governor shook his head in a token of reluctant admiration. We learn something now new every day, they tell me. Come on my lad. Evans made no show of resistance, and side by side the two men walked slowly down the stairs. Tell me, Evans, how did you manage to plan all this business? You have no visitors. I have seen to that. You have had no letters. I have got lots of friends, though. What's this supposed to mean, Mr. German teacher, for a start? You mean? But he was from the technical college. Evans, he almost enjoying it all, even check up on. I am, sir. God Almighty, there's far more going on that I always will be, sir. Everything ready? Asked the governor as they stood by the reception desk. The van's out of the front, said the pretty blonde receptionist. Evans winked at her and she winked back at him. I almost made his day. A silent prison offered handcuffed and recaptured Evans, and together the two men clambered awkwardly into the back seat of the prison van. See you soon, Evans. It was almost as if the governor were saying farewell to an old friend after a cocktail party. Cheerio, sir. I was just wondering. I know your German's pretty good. German is pretty good, sir. But you don't know any more of these modern languages. Not very well. Why? Evans settled himself comfortably on the back seat and grinned happily. Nothing really. I just happened to notice that you have got some O-level Italian classes coming up next September. That's all. Perhaps you won't be with us next September, Evans. James Rodernick Evans appeared to ponder the government's word deeply. No, perhaps I won't, he said. As the prison van turned right from the chopping Norton on to the Oxford Road, the hitherto silent prison officer unlocked the handcuffs and leaned forward towards the driver. For Christ's sake, get move on. I won't take him long to find it. Where do you suggest we make for? Asked the driver in a broad